So we continue with the skeleton system, and we had just done with the exoskeleton. Now we see the appendicular skeleton, bones of limbs and girdles. So first of all, we understand the bones of the limbs. So we start with the bones of the limbs. Bones of the forelimb and the hind limb largely correspond to each other. So yeah, we know that they are different, but you will find that the structure wise, they are quite similar, okay? They are corresponding to each other because यहाँ पे जैसे एक single bone है, तो इधर femur एक single bone है, यहाँ पे दो bone है, वैसे पैर में भी वहाँ पे दो bone है, then there are multiple bones here, similar there are multiple bones over there, so you will find that they are very much similar to each other. So let's see what they are made up of. The forelimb consists of single long bone humerus in the upper arm. So this arm, this one, this particular bone is the single bone which is the humerus. Two long bones in the lower arm, the radius on the side of the thumb and the ulna. So here, over here, there are two bones. One on the side of the thumb. You can see, you can feel it. So again, यहाँ पे ऊपर एक bone दिखे पता चलेगा और नीचे एक दूसरा bone है. So ये दोनों अलग अलग हैं. That is why we are able to twist this way. So ये two bones, the one which is towards the thumb, this one is the radius and the lower one is the ulna. So radius and ulna. Eight carpels or wrist on the wrist bone in the wrist. So there over here there are eight bones. So in this particular area there are eight bones. That's why we are able to do this gliding work like this. So eight bones over here, and then there are five metacarpals in the palm. So in this region there are five metacarpels for each and every. यहाँ पे एक दो तीन चार ऐसे करके पांच. The five metacarpals are there in the palm. And then there are 14 phalanges. So 14 phalanges are 3 here, 3 here, 3 here, 3 here. So that makes it 12. And then 2 over for the thumb. So that makes it total 14 phalanges. So these are 1, 2, 3 are 3 separate bones which are called as phalanges. So 3 here, 3 here, 3 here. And here it is only 2. So 1 and 2. So there are 14 phalanges. There are 5 metacarpals. Okay. And yeah, then the 8 wrist. To radius ulna over here and humerus over here. So 14 phalanges, 2 in the thumb and 3 each in the remaining 4 fingers. The hind limbs, that is the legs, consists of one long femur in the thigh, or the thigh bone, or the femur bone, which is the strongest one, which is the longest and the strongest bone of the body. Two long bones, the inner is tibia and the outer is fibia in the shank. That is the lower part, okay. 7 tarsal bones in the ankle. So, जैसे वहाँ पे metacarpals से वैसे यहाँ पे tarsals are there. So there are 7 tarsals in the ankle. 5 long metatarsals. So then, so जैसे 8 wrist bones थे वैसे पैर में there are 7 tarsals, okay. Then there are 5 metatarsals for the 5 fingers. And 5 long metatarsals, long bones in the middle of the foot, and finally 14 phalanges, just as those in the fingers. So 2 in the great toe and 3 each in the other 4 toes. The hind limbs have a additional bone called patella. So the jaise yahan pe the elbow is there, but there is not a bone, it's just the end of the bone. But in case of the knee joint has got a cap which is over there. The cap, the knee cap which is there is called as the patella or a kneecap, which is joined in the lower end of the femur. Kneecap is a bone developed from a tendon. Okay. The next part are the girdles. So two girdles, the shoulder girdle and the hip girdle. Girdles are the parts of the skeleton which help to articulate the limb bones to the main axial skeleton. So the connectivity between the axial skeleton and the appendicular skeleton are these girdles. Okay, these girdles are the one which are the connection between the two. There are two girdles, shoulder girdle and the hip girdle. The shoulder or the pectoral girdle consists of two flat triangular shoulder blade scapula, which lies dorsally on the upper ribs on either side of the vertebral column in the thorax cavity. So on the thorax cavity you can see. In fact, अगर तुम लोग को चाहिए अगर देखना है कि वो shoulder girdle क्या है, so बहुत पतला अगर आदमी रहेगा, when he does like this, you can hold the bone over here. वो bone में सब बाहर आता, so that is nothing but the shoulder girdle. Right. So its outer apex bears a large, somewhat cup-shaped glenoid cavity in which fits the rounded upper head of the humerus. So over here there is a cup-like structure which is to which the, suppose this is the humerus, is going to fix in like this. That is called as a glenoid cavity in which fits the upper head of the humerus. And close to these this joint, the shoulder blade has a small raised part to which a long and curved collarbone or clavicle is attached. So this is the clavicle which we see, maybe itna nahi dikhe, but there is a clavicle. This is the clavicle which is connected to the shoulder girdle. The other end of the collarbone is joined to the upper part of the sternum. So this, the clavicle is over here. और उसका यहां पे वो स्टर्नम में जो कनेक्ट हो रहा है वो यहां पे दिखता है. सिमिलरली द लोअर पार्ट, द हिप और द पेल्विक गर्डल इज अ लार्ज ट्रफ शेप पार्ट फॉर्म्ड बाय टू हिप बोन्स दैट आर जॉइंड मीडियली टू अ सैक्रम. सो द सैक्रम विच इज द स्टर्नम का जो नीचे जो पार्ट, सॉरी वर्टिब्रल कॉलम का जो नीचे पार्ट है, फ्रॉम देयर आर द टू हिप गर्डल्स विच आर formed over there they are medially joined, so these are medially joined with this sacrum. Each hip bone is made up of three fused bones, the ilium, ischium and pubis. On each side of it bears a large cup shaped cavity, articular cavity, that is acetabulum, into which it fits the large round headed head of the thigh bone. So the femur bone ka jo knob hai, that knob is going to connect to the particular part inside the articular cavity, that is the acetabulum of the hip girdle. The hip girdle not only gives support to the skeleton of the hind limbs but also protects the and supports the abdominal organs. So the abdominal organs, the kidney and all, are going to be supported by this particular hip girdle. Now, you'll always find there's a difference between the male skeleton and the female skeleton. The male skeleton is generally large and heavier. In the female skeleton, the pelvis or hip girdle is wider and the trough shape to adapt the for accommodating the fetus in the uterus during pregnancy. So, that's the main difference between the male and the female skeleton. The female skeleton, the male skeleton, the shoulder girdle will be broader and the hip girdle will be smaller. Whereas in female, the hip girdle will be broader because it needs to accommodate the baby, the fetus inside the uterus. So that's why it is going to be a broader hip girdle. So that was the different parts of the skeleton. You can see that there is a complete table 12.1 which gives the region wise what are the different bones present. So you see the skull contains the cranium, which is 8. Face has got 14, the ear ossicles, that is inside the ear, there are 6 bones, 3 into 2. And then the hoid, that is bone in the tongue, which is 1. So that makes it total 29 bones in the face itself. The vertebral column are 26 and ribs are 12 into 2 is 24 and sternum is 1. So that makes out the exoskeleton to be having 80 bones. And in case of appendicular, the forelimb has got the humerus, two radius, two ulna, carpals, 8 into 2, 16, metacarpals, 5 into 2 is 10, and phalanges, 14 into 2, 28. Similarly, for that makes 60 of them. And femur, hind limbs, mein femur is 2 femur, 2 tibia, 2 fibia, tarsals are 7 into 2, 14, metatarsals, 5 into 2, 10, and phalanges, 14 into 2, 28, and the 2 patella on each knee. So that is mixed out 60 in all. And the girdle, or the shoulder girdle, which has got the scapula, which is 2, and clavicle, which is 2, which is totally 4. Hip bone has got 2, so that totals to 6. So 80 plus 60 plus 60 plus 6 gives you total as 206, But if we consider the vertebral column to be 33 instead of 26, then there are 213 bones. So normally we consider 206 bones only. 213 will be there only if we consider that the vertebral column is 33 bones and the five fused together, usko agar hum log ek nahi gina, then it will make it into the total 213 bones. The next one we see are the joints. So of course we know that the bones are going to be connected to each other, and these are going to be connected so that the movement can be done, so that the movement is done with the help of the joints. The joints are such that they are always going to restrict certain movements and to enable certain movements. Like for example, we cannot move our fingers on this side. We cannot move it, you know, jaise hum log aise bend kar sakte hain, waise ye side pe bend nahi kar sakte hain, right? Why? Because the joints which are over here are such that they can have only certain degree of movement. See, our neck also, it goes up to around 270 degrees, okay? You cannot do 360 round, okay? But here you can go 360, the complete 360 you can go like this. So these are the different kinds of movements which are there. Even the back movement is like that, they are in certain... So all these are because of certain joints which are here. So the movement of the movement over your hand like this, wo pura circular movement. So wo jo bhi hai, we'll just have the different joints ka study over here now. The point at which two separate bones meet is called a joint. So where the two separate bones are going to meet each other are called as a joint. There are three major categories of joints in our body: immovable, partially movable, and freely movable. So first we go for the immovable joints, that are the skull. Skull, we know that there are eight bones over here, but these eight bones, they are immovable, they cannot move. So in immovable joints, in this type of joints, no movement is possible between the two bones. The structure between the bones of the cranium are examples of immovable joints. The second are partially movable joints. Here only very little movement occurs between the two bones. For example, the joints between the ribs and the breastbone, or between the vertebrates. So between the vertebrates and the breastbone, you can see that we can have a very restricted movement. We can just expand and contract the ribs, rib cage. That is the very small amount of movement which is there. So that's why we call it as a partially movable joints. And then are the freely movable joints. And the freely movable joints are again of four kinds, depending upon how much movement it is allowing. In this time, varying degrees of movements are possible between the two bones forming the joints. The four major types of movable joints are as follows. First, gliding joint. It occurs between the bones of the wrist and also between the bones of the ankle and as well as between the vertebrates. You can see, we can move it like this. So the vertebrates are able to move like this. So that is the gliding joint. Similar, the movement over here, this movement over here, that is the gliding joint, okay? So, wrist ka movement, vaise hi pair ka movement, so that are the gliding joints. So, these are the joints which are gliding joints, which give you a restricted movement over here. The next is pivoted joint. Here, one bone is rotated over a pivot-like head end and another bone, of end of another bone. For example, the skull is rotated on the upper end of the axis vertebra. So the axis and the atlas, they form this kind of a pivoted joint, which is like, ye aisa hai aur pura head idhar hai. So head can move on this particular axis. So that's why we are able to move it completely like this. Because ki head hai, aur this is the pivot, and on this basis, the head is going to move up and down and all the movements, like a joystick, you know, basically. So that is the pivot joint. Hinge joint. This joint moves like a hinge in one plane only, just like the hinges of the door. For example, elbow joint between the humerus and the ulna, joint between the bones of the fingers and toes, less perfectly the knee joint. The hinge joints usually give sufficient power. So this movement. The point is, because it cannot go in the other way around, that's why it gives you more power, because the body does not allow it to go in the other way around. That's why you get that much amount of strength in holding things, because you know, if it's in your hand, it will stay, you know that this finger will never go the other way around. So that's why we are able to hold things much more strongly because of the hinge joints. So hinge joints give you much sufficient power. And the final one are the ball and the socket joint. that has been over here. This is the ball and the socket. So the socket was like this, and the ball of the bone is coming over here, so that it gives you the complete movement inside the ball and the socket. So this is exactly the joystick. The ball and the socket here, one end of the bone, which is rounded and ball-like, fits into a cup-like depression of another bone. This joint provides movement in any direction. Two best examples are shoulder joint and the hip joint. In the shoulder joint, the head of the humerus fits into the socket glenoid cavity of the shoulder girdle. In the hip joint, the large ball-like head of the femur head fits into the deep socket acetabulum of the hip girdle. So that's what is the ball in the socket joint, which gives you the movement of all these movements of the hand is possible because of the ball and socket joint present in the shoulder. The next are the synovial joints. So synovial joints, the freely movable joints stated above, like the shoulder joint, the knee joint, are also called as synovial joint. This is mainly because there is one between the two bones, there is a gap, and that gap is being filled with a fluid which is called as a synovial fluid. So that it can give you a non-friction kind of a movement. So all these joints which are there, which is going to be much more like freely movable ones, they will be having a synovial thing. So that's why they are also called as synovial joints. They allow considerable degree of movement. These joints have very special requirements. Firstly, they should be held firmly in position, and secondly, the surface coming in contact should be well lubricated to remove friction. So that's the thing. So if we consider the elbow joint or we consider the knee joint, you know that the femur is over here and the humerus is, or the fibia and tibia are going to come over here. So accordingly, you will find that they are going to be having a good cushion between the two, so that they are less amount of, they are well lubricated and almost no friction. These joints have two special requirements. Firstly, they should be firmly in position, and secondly, the surface coming in contact should be well lubricated to remove friction. The lubricating fluid, wherever it occurs, is called the synovial fluid, and hence the name synovial joint. So that's the figure what they are given over here. So this is the type that if this was one bone and this is the other bone, so these two bones are over there, and then there is a cartilage over here and the cartilage over here, and to the sides are these particular kind of connective thing, which is the synovial membrane, and to this is filled this fluid, which is the synovial fluid. So this is the synovial fluid. Okay, and this is a synovial joint where this is one bone and this is the other bone. So the bone over here and the bone over here, and this is the connecting thing over at this point. The knee joint, for example, is a synovial joint. It is held in position by strong ligaments and is well protected by an outer fibrous capsule. So the knee joint, the figure of the knee joint is very important. They had asked once, many times in the school also, in their examinations, to draw a knee joint, because you need to draw the femur, the tibia, and then so you can also draw it in a simple manner. You can always draw it like this, that the bone over here, this is the femur, and then you can draw a tibia over here. So this is the tibia, and then you can show this kind of a movement here, and then you show a patella here, okay, and then you can just cover this thing. So this is how you can then just cover it like this. So this is the synovial fluid, this is the synovial area, this area is the synovial fluid. So quite easily done, not to worry about. You need not be very strong, you need not show the muscles and the tendons, you can just show the femur and the tibia and the synovial membrane in between. So the knee joint, for example, is a synovial joint. It heals in position by a strong ligament and is well protected by the outer fibrous capsule. The ligaments prevent dislocation in normal movement. The synovial fluid is contained in a sac formed of a very thin synovial membrane, and this sac serves as a cushion between the bones. So that's what they are shown over here, and this is the classification of the joints now. That joints are in the three categories, that is immovable, joints are of fixed type, bones of joints are joined by fibrous connective tissues very tightly, that is the skull bone. B is a partially movable joint, joints allow little movement, bones are joined with the help of cartilage. For example, joint between the sternum and the rib joints between the vertebrates. And then the freely movable joints, there are the synovial sac present between the two end of the bones. Filled with synovial fluid, joints are capable of free movements, elbow joint, hip joint, etc. And then there are the four of the different kinds of the synovial freely movable joints, such as gliding joint. Bones glide over each other to some extent. For example, wrist bone, ankle bone. Pivot joint, joints allow rotation about an axis, the pivot, the joint between the atlas and the axis vertebrae. The hinge joint allow movement, restricted movement in one place only. They are capable of bearing heavy load, that is the elbow or the knees and the fingers. And finally, ball and socket joint. Most movable joint, ball-like end of one bone articulates into cup-shaped depression of another bone so that structure could move in all planes. For example, shoulder and hip joint. So these are the different kinds of the joints, which is the classification of the joints. Now we see the next thing are the muscles. The muscles are the one which are connecting these kind of bones together. So the muscle in the body provides the means of all movements. So the complete expansion contraction of the muscle is going to bring about the movement of the bones. Hence, the complete movement is going to be dependent on the muscles. They cover the skeletal framework and also give contour shape to the body. So the complete body shape. See, if the skeleton is there, it is not giving you a proper shape. The muscular shape and all is the muscles which are giving that particular shape. The shape of the body as such, the shape of the face, and these are the muscles which are giving that particular shape to the contour shape to the body. Muscles help in maintaining body posture while sitting, standing, or walking. Most muscles are long bundles of contractile tissue. Each muscle usually have two ends, a fixed end where the muscle originates and a movable end which pulls some other part. This movable end is drawn out to form a tough structure, the tendon, which is attached to the bone. When stimulated by a nerve, the muscle contracts to become shorter and thicker, and thus it pulls the bone at a movable end. Muscles can only contract and relax and cannot lengthen. So you can see the muscles, what they do is that this over part over here is going to just contract, and due to the contraction, the bone over here is going to get extended, you know, the coming over here. And when you relax this, they come back to its original position. So normally they are just going to become shorter and thicker. So they just contract or become shorter and thicker, and they cannot elongate, they cannot stretch, because the muscles are never elastic in nature. They cannot stretch or lengthen. Now muscles, there is a particular kind of muscle which is called as antagonistic muscles. Now antagonistic muscles are a structure which has been moved by a muscle, cannot return to its original position without action of another muscle. See over here, one muscle is going to work, yahan pe wo contraction hoga, to ye haath idhar aayega. But then this muscle cannot bring it this back into original position. For that, another set of muscles are going to contract and they are going to bring it this way. So this muscle is going to bring it up, and this muscle over here are going to bring it back. So accordingly, you will find that two muscles are going to do the work in opposite direction. So you see that a structure which when moved by a muscle cannot return to its original position without the action of the another muscle. Such muscles causing opposing movements are called antagonistic muscles. For example, the biceps, the femur muscle of the upper arm, flexes, that is, bends the lower arm over the upper arm. Straightening or extension of the lower arm is brought about by the triceps, that is, the extenders, which are, so triceps are going to extend it over here. Therefore, these two muscles are antagonistic muscles. The kinds of muscles, we have got three kinds of muscles: voluntary, involuntary, and cardiac. There are about 650 muscles in our body, making up nearly one half of the body weight. These muscles fall in two categories: voluntary muscles, which are under control of our will, and involuntary muscles, which are not in control of our will. So either the muscles will be of two kinds, one is voluntary or involuntary. कि कार्डियक की साइड ही डिफरेंट। वॉलेंट्री यानी क्या, जो हमारे कंट्रोल में, आई कैन लिफ्ट माई हैंड्स मूवमेंट, ये जो है वो मेरे कंट्रोल में, दैट आर मसल्स विच आर इन माई कंट्रोल, दे आर वॉलेंट्री मसल्स। द मसल्स ऑफ द लंग्स और the intestine और the stomach and all, they are the one which are not in my control, okay? Because they are not in my control, that's why they are involuntary muscles, okay? So the muscles which are involuntary, that means they are not in my control, are called as involuntary muscles. Some muscles like those of the eyelids, diaphragm, are both voluntary as well as involuntary. Cardiac muscles make up the walls of the heart. They are capable of rapid movement and do not tire easily. So because the heart is continuously pumping, that's why its movement is very strenuous. And because it should not get tired, that's why they are made up of the material which is similar to the voluntary muscles. But they are actually involuntary muscles. That's why they have got a separate category altogether, that the walls of the heart are made up of cardiac muscles. Coordinating of the muscles, most actions in our body like standing, walking, running, playing tennis, etc. require combined action of several muscles to great extent. The muscles have to be coordinated for a particular kind of movement. So we find that the coordination is so nice, you know, in our body, the coordination is so nice that we will eat food. Let's say a simple example, we are eating food. So the way we take the piece of the food and then bring it over here, it's so well coordinated, it goes into the mouth only. Can it ever happen that wo khate khate haath mein chala gaya ya naak pe chala gaya? Nahi, it never happens, you know, it will, because it is so well coordinated that even if you are watching something continuously, you know, involuntarily we are eating. We are eating the food almost like involuntarily. It means you don't even come to know that what the way you are eating. You are just watching a movie or watching a television and you are eating as if jaise khane ke liye tum logo ko efforts hi nahi laga. So that's the coordination of the muscles which is so nice. Finally, the liver mechanism. Movement of the different parts of the body are usually made easy due to the liver action in the skeleton. We said that one of the functions of the skeleton was leverage. So this is basically what we are talking about. It makes the work done by us easy because it is forming into a liver. The liver of the first order, where the power P and the weight W X on with the fulcrum F is between, is represented by the extension of arm of an elbow by the action of the triceps and result A and resting of the skull on the first and the second neck vertebrae, the liver of second order. So you can see the liver of the first order over here is the one which is we holding some object, like I holding the object and doing like this. So this movement, the fulcrum is at the over here, the load is over here and the effort is over here. So fulcrum being at the center, this gives you the first order liver. So the first order liver is the one in which fulcrum is at, in the center, and load and the arm are on the other two sides. Similarly, the neck movement is also this way. The load is at the one side, this is the muscle movement, and the fulcrum is in the center, that is the atlas. The liver of the second order, where the fulcrum is at the end of the liver and power of the, at one end and the weight of the in between, is represented by the gastrocnemius muscles raising weight of the body on the toe. So if I raise my body on the toe at that time, I can see the toe becomes a fulcrum. So fulcrum is at one end, the body weight is acting at the center, and the when you go up like this, you'll find that the calf muscles of yours, they are going to get that particular effort which is applied at the calf muscle. So the calf muscles act as the effort. So that's why effort is on one side, the load is in the center, that is the complete body weight, and then is the toe part is the fulcrum. So that is the class 2 liver. And the liver of class 3, where the fulcrum is at one end and the weight is at the other end, and the power, that is the effort, is in between, that is the bicep being flexing of the arm. So bicep, when you're flexing the arm at that time, it is going to give you the third order liver. So if I'm holding this thing, it is the first order liver, but when I'm flexing my muscles over here like this, at that time it is the third order liver. So because this is the effort over here and the load is at the center, because the fulcrum is at other end. So so this is going to be the third order liver. So that's why the three order of livers are given over here. They're given here in that figure 12.15 that the first one is about the elbow joint. The elbow joint, the tricep work and the elbow joint, that is the first order. The second order limb is about the toe means toe ke upar khada rehna. And the third order is for the elbow joint, but it is where flexing of the bicep. So that is the third order limb. Do you know the longest bone in your body is the thigh bone? The smallest bone in your body are the three tiny bones, malleus, inner, and stapes, in the ear joint to the inner side of the eardrum in the form of a chain. The nails and the teeth, though hard, are not bones. And most muscles are attached to the bones, but some are not. For example, the muscles which move our eyelids or the muscles that pushes the food through the food canal are not attached to the bones. And finally, some muscles in our body are vestigial, non-functional, such as the muscles of the projecting ears, like these are others. In other mammals, mein kya hota hai? Wo kaan aise aise karte hain jisse flies wagera ko uda sake. So other mammals like the cow or the horse can move the ears. Some persons also have, with some efforts, can learn to move their ears slightly. So yeah, that is this, they can move this particular part over here. So that's anyway, this is the some, do you know, facts about the muscles. Okay, so this is the end of the chapter, a very small chapter and quite an interesting one, very short, nothing difficult in over here. Some simple mainly what is there is the different kind of the bones which are here, which you need to study properly. The vertebral column and all, they are slightly difficult to understand. Otherwise, everything is quite simple. Yeah, that's all for the chapter. Right? Thank you.